Good morning. Peace to you from God our Father and grace from our living Savior Jesus Christ. We welcome you to this WhiteStone worship service on the fourth Sunday of Lent. I just have one announcement, and that is to invite you to, or remind you, to join us for our Bible study on Touchtown. That is our in-house TV service, channel 1390. You can view it at 1:30 Monday, 10 a.m. Tuesday, or 4 p.m. on Thursday. So you have three different chances to participate in that service. Now, we're going to have just a couple switches in order in the service today. People at home won't mind because they're not looking at the bulletin. But I particularly want to ask your permission to take the gathering prayer time to just spend a little time in discussing and praying for support and comfort. I know that some of you do not know Tommy Jones at all. You may have heard his name, and you may not have even heard his name. That's hard for most of us to believe, but it's true because many of you are new. But so many of us, and so many of those of you who are watching at home, have known and loved Tommy and Jill for years and years and years. Tommy has been the leader and integral part of this campus for decades. And he continues to bless us every single day. It's been my privilege to know Tommy and Jill for a number of years, and we've watched Tommy go through a number of health events, always with the strength and the faith that only God can provide. Some of you know that for some time now, Tommy's experienced pain and pneumonia and other medical conditions. And yesterday, the doctors did confirm the test that he does have terminal pancreatic cancer, along with multiple tumors. Tommy and Jill were as prepared for that news as anyone can be, but of course, no one really is. Together, through prayer, they have made the decision that he will not seek further treatment or chemo. And further, they've decided to remain in their apartment and receive hospice services here on campus. Tommy says he wants to remain here because of the love he has for WhiteStone, and especially the love he has for so many of the residents and the board members here. This is truly his home. Well, those of us who know and love him want to do something to help, and we know how hard that is, and we want to support Jill. Well, what they need and covet are our prayers, and they need their quiet, personal time together. But if you'd like to drop a card in the little basket outside their door, he will really appreciate and enjoy them. And so I ask that you join me in this special time of prayer for our Chaplain Emeritus, Tommy Jones. Almighty God, we give thanks for Tommy Jones and pray that he and Jill may be comforted and his suffering may be made whole in a way that only you can perceive and ordain. Lord, when they're afraid, give them courage. When they feel weak, grant them strength. When they're afflicted, give them patience. And when they are lost, offer them hope. When they're alone, let them feel you by their side. And Lord, we pray for all of us who have known and loved Tommy for so long. Guide our thoughts and prayers and comfort us with your peace, the peace that passes all understanding. When the time comes that Tommy is taken from this earthly life, we pray that you will carry him in your arms to the perfect place that you have prepared just for him. We pray this in the holy name of Jesus, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, now and forevermore. Amen. And now let us join our hearts together as we prepare to worship God. Thank you. There my raptured soul shall find peace beyond the river. Thank you, Christ. Well, now I invite you to join together with me for our call to worship. It's on the screen for those of you at home, and it's in your bulletins if you're here in the chapel. We gather to share in our love of God.
Lord, open our hearts and let us share your good news.
We gather to share our witness to God's goodness.
Lord, let our minds bear witness to serve us with your
people. We gather here to praise God, whose love is eternal.
Lord, open our hearts today to sing your praises. Amen.
Our opening hymn for this worship service is "To God Be the Glory."
Thank you.
But let us read and consider the Testament reading in Psalms 107, verses 1 through 3, and 17 through 22. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story. Those he redeemed from the land of the foe, those he gathered from the lands from east and west, from north and south, some because fools thought their rebellious ways and suffered affliction because of their iniquities. They loathed all food and drew near the gates of death. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble. He saved them from their distress. He sent out the word and healed them. He rescued them from the grave. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for mankind. Let them sacrifice thanks offering and tell the word of his works and songs of joy. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
And now I invite you to join your hearts, your minds, and your spirits with mine as together we go to God in prayer. Great triune God, we have gathered here in your name as an act of faith, believing that you are not only among us, but that you love us. It's often hard to recognize your love, to see your mercy, and to feel your presence. Help us today in our worship that we might be transparent to your grace as you reveal yourself to each one of us. Through Jesus Christ, you bring salvation to the world. Give us strength to believe in him that we may share in his victory over the power of death and fulfill the purpose for which you have made us. Almighty God, open your word and illumine our darkened world that we may see clearly and live faithfully by the light of your truth in Jesus Christ. Sisters and brothers, confident in God's love and mercy, let us pray now for the world and for our needs. Holy God, you created us in Christ Jesus for good works. We pray now that you would help those who profess faith in Christ to do good in the world, following the way of life you have prepared for those who believe in him. Your children walk by your light, God, doing what is true, and yet we acknowledge that salvation isn't earned by our good works, but through trust in your grace. Dispel from each of us, your children, any arrogance of heart, that the world may be drawn to your truth by our humble witness. In every age, you have called forth men and women of integrity to lead your people in the way of righteousness. We pray that you would help pastors and teachers everywhere fulfill their calling. Give them the courage to speak truth in love. You have shown your love for the world. Receive our prayers. Grant us what we need. Save us from perishing and, Lord, bring us to everlasting life. We lift up to you at this time our Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Well, I know how sharp some of you are, and you have probably figured out by now that this service is going to be all about the love of God. And so if you don't like hearing about how much God loves you, you may not want to listen to the rest of the service, because now we sing our second hymn, Love Divine, All Loves Excel. Let's sing together. John 3, verses 14 through 21. Interesting. Okay, hear now from the gospel message. And as Moses lifted up the serpents in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Jesus be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God. May God bless the reading and the hearing of the gospel message. Amen. Now that we've heard this beautiful passage, just a pivotal part of our faith, I invite us to close our eyes, bow our heads, whatever makes you comfortable, and let's have a beautiful moment of meditation as we hear these profound words yet again.
We pray, please, on me.
You know, to preach the love of God is to preach the heart of God. Whether our message addresses ministry to the sick, global missions, evangelism, social justice, or family issues, this message is always rooted in God's love. Or it isn't rooted in God. May the Holy Spirit open up our innermost being to what God wants most, to give love to us and to receive love from us. There's nothing in this entire universe that can compare with God's love. If we try to compare human love, full of selfishness and pettiness and prejudice, to God's holy, sacrificial, unending love, we can see immediately that human love is often a counterfeit love. How do we measure what real love is? John 3:16 is the rubric for what real love is all about. For God so loved the world. This verse begins by announcing that God loved us, all of us, even before we loved him. It would be nice if it said that we first loved God, but the truth of the matter is, however, that human beings are actually not very adept at this pure, true love business. I think we usually mean well, but if there's one lesson from human history, it's that we can hate just as easily as we can love. We can hate in the name of him whose very nature is love. There's another place in Scripture that says something profound about love. In 1 John 4:8, we read these powerful words. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. And then later in verse 10, this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us. Think about those words for a moment. Whoever does not love does not know God. It always sickens me when I discover and remember just how often people have hated, supposedly in the name of God. They certainly can't justify such vile behavior with the New Testament. Remember 1 Corinthians 13, how Paul wrote, though I speak with the tongues of men and angels and have not love, I'm like a tinkling brass or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries, and I have faith that can move mountains, but I don't have love, I'm nothing. If I give everything I have to the poor and give over my body to be burned that I might boast, but don't have love, I gain nothing. My dear friends, this is what the gospel is all about. Love. Because we've learned as little children, God is love. God's the measure of real love, and it's only by God's Spirit that we're able to know and share real love. God loved us before we were even capable of loving him in return. That's always a risk, isn't it? To be the one who expresses love first, to put your heart out there and hope the other person feels the same way about you. Not our God. He didn't wait for us to love him. God knew that we would break his heart. God loved us knowing full well that we would never be able to return his love in equal measure. His love is truly unconditional. Notice that John 3:16 doesn't say, for God so loved good people who love God back. It says, for God so loved the world. No limitations, no exclusions. Are you a part of this world? Then you are completely lovable in God's eyes. God loved us first. And that's the first thing we need to see in this passage. The second is that this verse tells us how much God loves us. It seems easier than ever for anyone to say, I love you, or I love this or that. People say it all the time. And sometimes they even mean it. But it's a very different thing to put our love into action. To give up your own life to ensure that others could live Is there any greater love than this? God loved us first. God loved us enough that he gave his one and only son. And why does scripture tell us that he gave up that part of his triune self? We know the answer, don't we? That whosoever believes in him might not perish, but have everlasting life. God doesn't remove evil. God offers us a solution for the crises and the evil and the damaging things that come into our life. He provides a way of salvation. God didn't save the Israelites by taking the serpents away. The Israelites were saved by faith in God's ability to save them. Some people do face enormous hardships in life. We've prayed over one today. So many are in various forms of crisis as we have gathered. It's faith that sees them through such struggles. I was reminded of a story of one person's life that highlights this for us. There was a 7-year-old boy who watched his family forced out of their home because of a legal technicality. And he had to work to help support them. At age 9, his mother died. At age 22, he lost his job as a store clerk. He'd wanted to go to law school, but he didn't have the education to get into law school. At 23, he went into debt to become a partner in a small store. But at 26, his business partner died, leaving him with a huge debt that it took him years to repay. At 28, after dating a young woman for 4 years, he asked her to marry him, and she said no. At 37, on his third try, he was elected to Congress. But just 2 years later, he lost his re-election. At 41, his 4-year-old son died. At 45, he ran for the Senate and lost. At 47, he failed as the vice presidential candidate. At 49, he ran for the Senate again and lost. And at 51, he was elected president of the United States and became one of the greatest leaders of our nation. And when someone asked Abraham Lincoln what enabled him to endure a life of hardship, he answered with just 3 words: faith in God. Let's look at another person that's not so famous. You've probably never heard of him. This man's name is George Benard. Now, back in the early 20th century, George was struggling with personal problems that were causing him a great deal of trouble and anguish. But in his suffering, his mind kept returning again and again to the idea of Christ anguishing on the cross. He saw this as the heart of the gospel. The cross he pictured wasn't fancy, ornate, pretty, or gold or silver. It was, in Benard's words, a rough, splintery thing, stained with gore. He says, "I saw the Christ of the cross, as if I were seeing John 3:16 leave the printed page, take form, and act out the meaning of redemption." John 3:16. And so in a room in Albion, Michigan, Benard sat down and wrote a tune. But then he struggled to get his thoughts to come together for lyrics. He struggled for weeks to set words that would go with that beautiful melody. Sometime later, Benard was scheduled to preach in New York. And again, he found himself focusing on the cross. That theme of the cross grew increasingly more urgent to him. He worked once more with the words to this hymn, and this time the lines came. He later shared with a friend, "I sat down and immediately was able to rewrite the stanzas of the song without so much as one word failing to just fall right in place." And so on June 7th, 1913, George Benard introduced the new hymn in a revival meeting that he was holding in Michigan. The words went like this: "On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. And I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cherish the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. And we know the old rugged cross became one of the most beloved hymns of Christian faith. John 3:16. That's the effect that that verse has on so many people. Back in the 16th century, Martin Luther called John 3:16 the gospel in miniature. He said if all you had of the New Testament was this one verse, it would be enough to save your soul. I worry that those of us who have been, as we call it, churched our whole lives, have heard this so often that we're tempted to take it for granted. That would be tragic. We may even forget that God's grace overcomes our sin. And let's be honest, it's always been much easier for us humans to offer each other judgment and criticism rather than grace. But God's grace overcomes our sin. Of course, we know that there are consequences for sin. They don't disappear. But the message of this amazing passage is that God offers amazing grace to a world that truly deserves his condemnation. Though the world didn't believe in God, God believed in the world. That's still the message today. Undeserved grace is the foundation of salvation. Such extravagant grace calls for a radical response. We accept God's gift of grace when we commit ourselves to follow Christ through faith. God calls to a sinful world. Our response echoes God's call of love, devotion, and forgiveness. Alfred Vanderbilt was a great-grandson of the billionaire Cornelius Vanderbilt, the family that one of their descendants built the Biltmore House in Asheville. But there was nothing particularly praiseworthy about how Alfred lived his life. He used his massive inheritance to invest in real estate and horses and to throw lavish parties, you know, just like we all do. But here's why we remember Alfred Vanderbilt. In 1915, he set sail on the Lusitania heading toward London. Now, some of us remember that at this time, Europe was embroiled in World War I. But nobody thought that enemy troops would attack a civilian ship. Sadly, they were wrong. German U-boats attacked the Lusitania as it sailed off the coast of Ireland. Now, as a first-class passenger, Vanderbilt was guaranteed a life jacket and a seat on one of the first lifeboats leaving the ship. But Alfred Vanderbilt refused his rights. He gave away his life jacket and his seat on the lifeboat. And as the ship slowly sank into the water, Alfred Vanderbilt focused on one thing, getting as many children as possible into the lifeboats as he could. He died saving those children. And a New York Times journalist described the moment as gallantry which no words of mine can describe. How do you describe a love that's unearned, undeserved, given freely and generously and sacrificially for the sake of everyone, whether they can ever return that love or not? That's God's love. God had a million reasons to condemn the world, but he didn't. God saved the world by giving the absolute greatest gift he could give, himself in the form of the human Jesus. And God made us a promise that whoever believes, yes, whoever believes in Jesus Christ will not perish, but have eternal life. So, what's your response to that amazing promise, to that amazing grace?
Was blind, but now I'm found. Was blind, but
Receive this benediction. As God has shared the best with you, now you are challenged to go forth to share your blessings with others. May the peace and love of God go with you always. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you. Thank you.